It's an unfortunate reality of air travel that emergency and crash landings occur from time to time. Fortunately, these are relatively rare when you consider how many flights take place on a daily basis. Nonetheless, for larger aircraft, an unplanned landing anywhere other than an airport usually means the plane will need to be dismantled and scrapped for parts. So why is this the unfortunate reality of emergency landings? The answers may seem obvious, but in this video, let's look at some real-world cases, the list of reasons, and the intriguing exceptions. Interestingly, two good examples of commercial passenger aircraft landing in fields come from the same airline, Ural Airlines of Russia. The first instance took place in August 2019. The flight, operated by an A321200, encountered a flock of seagulls and experienced a bird strike affecting both engines. As per the Aviation Herald, the first bird strike resulted in a complete loss of power in the left engine. A second bird strike then caused the right engine to produce insufficient thrust to maintain flight. Consequently, the crew was forced to perform a crash landing in a cornfield 5 kilometers or 3.1 miles from the airport. While everyone on board survived, the aircraft was damaged beyond repair and thus had to be scrapped in situ, or in place. Fast forwarding to September 2023, the other Ural Airlines incident involved an A320-200 landing in a wheat field. The reasons for the aircraft diverting make up a longer story. However, to make this long story short, a diversion to an alternate airport consumed more fuel than anticipated, and it was decided that a wheat field would have to do. Again, there were no fatalities. This time, however, the aircraft landed in fairly good condition, and the airline initially decided that a recovery flight out of the field should be planned. While the airline waited for winter to come and the ground to freeze and harden, the plan to fly the aircraft out was eventually scrapped. Examining these two cases alone, it's already clear that a few factors must be taken into consideration for an aircraft to be flown out of an emergency landing site, including aircraft condition and the runway surface. But going point by point, here is a full list of considerations. Aircraft condition will be the first major factor preventing an aircraft from flying out of its crash landing site. If the landing gear is extended, then it may be damaged as the wheels roll over rocky or uneven terrain. Alternatively, the wheels may be retracted in order for the fuselage to better slide across the uneven ground, but for low-wing aircraft designs, the result will be engine damage due to the reduced clearance. This can be clearly seen with the Ural A321 landing in the cornfield. Pilots landed with the wheels retracted, and both the aircraft engines sustained significant damage. The terrain will be the other obvious factor. Even if the airframe, engines, and landing gear are undamaged from the landing, any surface with enough big bumps and holes is sure to prevent the aircraft from gaining enough speed and lift to fly out. In the case of a grassy field, the surface may also be too soft, especially after the rain. The more recent A320 incident in the Russian wheat field would have been close to ideal under the plan to fly out once the field had frozen over. It's unclear why the airline gave up on this plan, but even the prospect of taking off from a frozen wheat field requires many considerations, including the quality of the surface. As you may know from an old simple flying video on Antarctic blue ice runways, even takeoffs from icy, snowy surfaces require preparation and equipment. Indeed, the runways in Antarctica are well maintained to ensure flight safety, with graders and snow-blowing equipment used to clear and level the surface of the ice. Crews also work to prevent snow from blowing across, which would reduce the already limited grip. Thin grooves are also cut into the surface with rake-like plowing equipment to add further traction. But finally, runway length will need to be considered. Even if the surface is smooth and level enough, it's improbable that such a surface extends far enough for the aircraft to gain sufficient lift, apart from perhaps salt flats. Prevailing headwinds and tailwinds, as well as the aircraft's weight, will need to be calculated in order to determine the minimum distance. But it's safe to say that, in most cases, there won't be enough runway distance to safely attain the proper speed for generating lift. Also, planners will have to consider the risk of foreign object debris on or adjacent to the runway surface. Without the well-controlled conditions found at a typical commercial airport, aircraft engines could ingest this debris, resulting in damage during a critical phase of the operation. At this point, more knowledgeable aviation enthusiasts may be thinking, yes, but what about insert exception here? Yes, there are obviously many instances of aircraft taking off from imperfect surfaces. Typically, these cases involve smaller general aviation aircraft or larger military aircraft designed to handle less than perfect conditions. Engineers and pilots conduct rigorous tests on military aircraft like the C-17 to determine the limits of performance on dirt runways during dry, wet, and muddy runway conditions. Additionally, to reduce the risk of engines ingesting foreign object debris, tactical military transport aircraft tend to have high wing designs that put additional distance between engines and the ground. And when it comes to commercial jets, there are special modifications that can be made to certain aircraft. A popular example comes from northern Canadian carriers like Nolinor. For projects in remote areas, the airline 737-200s can be equipped to land on dirt, gravel, or ice runways. Ultimately, all the examples listed above involve unpaved runways, but sufficiently smooth or level runways nonetheless. Grass runways are limited to lighter, smaller aircraft, but also carry their own set of risks, namely soft ground. The 1988 incident involving a Tacker 737-300 might be the closest example of a larger commercial jet recovering after an emergency landing. The aircraft experienced a double-engine flameout and ended up landing on a levee. The landing was successfully completed on a grass strip section of the levee measuring 1,818 meters in length and 36 meters in width, or 6,060 feet by 120 feet wide. While landing intact with minimal damage, the location was still unsuitable for takeoff. The initial plan was to remove the jet's wings and transport everything to a repair facility by barge. However, it was subsequently decided that the aircraft could have its engines changed and towed to a nearby location suitable for takeoff. The 737 was towed over to a road named Saturn Boulevard, which was coincidentally a World War II-era runway that had been paved over. While it may be the closest case of a large commercial aircraft performing an emergency landing outside of a proper airport and eventually flying out, the unique geographic location and its proximity to a wide road were major factors in the success of the recovery operation. When it comes to smaller jets, there's the 1983 case of a Gulfstream II that had to divert and make an emergency landing at a horse racing course in Ireland. The plane, which landed due to insufficient fuel, suffered minor wing damage after striking a fence post upon landing, but was otherwise still fit to fly. The pilot was insistent that he would be flying his aircraft out, quote, once the ground dries out. It didn't exactly go to plan, but the pilot and his crew ended up flying the private jet out on a temporary 3,000-foot tarmac runway after staying in the town of Mallow for nearly 40 days. Sadly, as nice as it would be to recover an aircraft that has performed an emergency landing somewhere other than an actual runway, we can see that there are too many factors working against this possibility. Furthermore, the possibility of constructing a suitable runway and paving over fields would likely not be worth it. Thus, as stated at the start of this video, it's all but guaranteed that any such aircraft will need to be dismantled. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.